For those of you who came just to this lecture and didn't attend the previous lecture, my name is Yuri Panchul. I work as engineer in a company called Wave Computing, in a part of the company called MIPS. So MIPS is actually a very well-known organization from the early 80s. The founder of MIPS was a president of Stanford and a creator of MIPS architecture and the best known textbook on computer architecture. So right now I'm working on a neural net accelerator chip. So this chip allowed to compute neural net inference and neural net computations like orders of magnitude faster than software. So I'm working in two teams. One is neural net team in Campbell, and another is a processor team in Santa Clara. And also I'm working with our company team in Shanghai, in China. So in these two lectures, I'm giving you some first introduction to let you start a career in microelectronic design. But even if you're not going to be electrical engineer, it is still very useful for you to understand how hardware works, because if you're going to be just a purely software engineers, you should be aware that during the past decades, processor performance was growing mostly because of increase of processor frequency and shrinking of semiconductor transistor. But right now we pretty much reached this limit, and in order to compute things faster, we have to create a special architectures like architecture of this neural net chip I'm working on right now. This chip has very many, tens of thousands of small processor-like units working in parallel. When you program such units, you need to understand what part of your algorithm is to put into software and what part is to put into hardware. So now let me share the screen and let's go to review a couple of slides from previous lecture. Okay, so can you hear, can you see the screen?
No, not yet.
Okay, can you see it now? Oh, I have to share the screen. Sorry, how to share the screen? Share. Okay, so can you see?
Yes, we can see now.
Okay, so let me share the screen. So let's get some refreshment of knowledge from the first lecture. In a computer, we have a software-hardware dualism. So we have if you look back into 1930s, 1940s, at that moment there were digital systems already. So there were some large boxes working with switches with electromagnetic relays and vacuum tubes, but there were no software in a modern sense. So the concept of software or a program, it appeared in 1940s when first computers ENIAC, EDVAC, and the Soviet project MESA were created. So essentially, in any computer since that time, we have a computer circuit, which is a central processor unit that fetches software as a sequence of instructions from a memory, where software is stored as a chain of processor words with zeros and ones. And when we talk about software, we talk about this chain of instructions. And when we talk about hardware, we talk about this circuit. So in software, we create program in a high-level language like C, and then translate it into machine instructions. And in hardware, we also have hardware description languages, but we translate them not into chain of instructions, but we translate them straight into hardware itself. So they eventually become a transistor on a physical chip created from silicon and copper, aluminum, boron, phosphorus, and other chemicals. So now, what is a PGA? So in the first lab and in this second lab, you're working with FPGA, which is a field programmable gate array. So a field programmable gate array is a matrix of cells with a changeable function. So one cell can become AND, another OR, and yet another one bit of memory. And FPGA itself does not have CPU, but it can be configured to work as a CPU. So before 80s, before FPGAs were created, or like even like before any programmable logic chips were created, like back in 70s, if you create integrated chip, you have to create a design and send it to a factory, which charges you a large fee. Like factory at that time charged you like hundreds of thousands of dollars to make the first chip. And once you make first chip, then rest of chips are much cheaper. You just pay royalty. But with FPGA, you can put design to FPGA by just writing data about FPGA configuration into a special memory called configuration memory. And bits from that memory are used in a block called multiplexer, which defines how each cell is working. So one cell is working as one logical function, another like as another. So now we will shift from a combinational logic to sequential logic. So during the previous lecture, we were talking about combinational logic. So this type of logic allow you to create a hardware for functions. Each function has several inputs and one or multiple outputs. And essentially, in order to compute something, you just put data to your inputs, wait some time, and get data on your output. So this type of logic is useful if you want to compute something like add or multiply. But even if you want to compute some function like sinus, you need a lot of such logic to compute. In order to do something interesting, you need your circuit to have a memory. So we also should notice that unlike software, in hardware we have concept of physical memory. And if you have a block of logic like those ANDs, ORs, or exclusive ORs, when signal goes through those logic element, it takes time, because we are dealing with physics here, not just purely logic. So it takes time to charge gate of transistor. You go through a typical logic element, like if it's a high speed element, during like several picoseconds, but it still takes time. So how to find when the results of your computation are ready? In order to do this, we are using a special signal called clock. And this clock measures time in our circuit. So here you can see a timing diagram where clock goes up and down, and we can measure time when a computation for your combinational circuit is finished. So clock is simply a special signal that goes up and down with a period. And when you buy a computer in a store, and when a computer system is advertised as having like 3 gigahertz clock or like 1.2 gigahertz clock, this is one of the main clocks used in this specific processor. Actually, complicated circuits usually use multiple clocks, but when we buy computer in a store, the advertised clock is usually the main clock used by processor itself, by processor core. So cluster may use different clock. Now, in order to generate clock, there is a device clock called crystal oscillator, and you can find this crystal oscillator on your board. So now any circuit which is synchronized with the clock is called sequential. So the reason for this name is that a sequential circuit goes through a sequence of states. It has a current state which is stored in a so-called D flip-flop. Then it has a new state based on previous state and the circuit input. And the new state is recorded into a D flip-flop when clock goes from low to high. And the output of the module are computed based on inputs and the current state. So you can see on this timing diagram, the clock goes up and down, and you have current state, you have inputs, you have new state, and you have outputs. So basically, any computer system can be like any computer, like any chip you have in a game machine or in a cell phone, anywhere. You can represent using so-called Huffman model of sequential circuits. So in this Huffman model, you have inputs, you have outputs, you have combinational cloud, which is a logic that computes new state and outputs based on inputs and previous state, and you have a clock, which tells when to write a new state. Now, I like to use a special model for sequential logic called Chinese room experiment. But before we go this, let's go back to that manga which we were using during our first lecture. So let me switch to here. Yes, so. Yeah, so basically this manga explains what just I showed to you, that we have a combinational circuits and we have sequential circuits. And during the first lecture, we studied combinational circuits that can do AND or NOT. So you can build adder from those circuits. But in order to have memory, in order to do anything interesting, a circuit should have its state. So, and without its state, nothing can work really. But once you have state, a computer can do something interesting. So each such circuit is built from a combinational logic and a D flip-flop, which is in Russian called a trigger. A trigger is actually obsolete term initially used by IBM, while like all other companies were using term flip-flop. Flip-flop means like switching up and down. Most books on digital design, they are talking about RS, LH, and JK flip-flop and T flip-flop. And especially books which were published in like 60s or 70s or 80s, they had like long description of different flip-flops. However, in modern circuits, like circuits we design in our office or design like Intel or like Apple office, it's essentially a lot of combinational logic and the D flip-flops. And the reason is that the D flip-flops, they are compatible with the modern synthesis methodology, which originated in late 80s and was used for the last 30 years. Yeah, so manga shows how D flip-flop works. So it has two parts, so-called master and slave, but I will just skip it. The most important thing for you to know is that D flip-flop is a device that has input D and which has output Q and which has a clock signal. And Q is connected to the internal state, and this state gets when clock goes from low to high, D becomes Q, and all other time D is simply ignored. So this is what you need to know about D flip-flop. So now let's go back to our slides. Yeah, what sequential logic allows us to do? Sequential logic allows us to do counting, to like count some numbers, memorizing information, adding new data and repeating computation. It allows us to wait for an event coming. So sequential logic makes the computer to do interesting things. So what you can see on this picture is a so-called Chinese room salt experiment. It's an experiment which it's like a salt experiment which is popular in the area of artificial intelligence. So okay, let me see if I put this in details. No, I didn't. So basically, during the last 70 years, from 1950s, many professors, starting from Professor John McCarthy in Stanford University, like as well as Marvin Minsky from MIT and like other professors, they were telling since 50s that we are going to have artificial mind created during our lifetime. And there were like several waves of artificial intelligence. And back in 1980s, a person named John Searle proposed the following thought experiment. So suppose we have a large book that writes a rule in a form, suppose that we have a large room with two holes, and a person can put some like pieces of paper with Chinese characters written on this paper. And then like person from inside the room can give some Chinese characters back. And suppose person inside the room has a book with many rules telling that if you have this and that Chinese character, you need to give back, and you had some sequence of Chinese characters before, then you need to give back another character. And this is essentially something which can be implemented using this sequential circuit. And for external observer outside the room, he may get an impression that this room is talking to him in Chinese language, even if a person. So, and John Searle was saying that this is essentially a limitation of a computer, that it can create an appearance of artificial intelligence, but because such computer lacks some self-conscious, we cannot really call it like artificial intelligence. So I created another illustration of how sequential circuit works. So suppose we get this Chinese room that recognizes like a statement that consists of Chinese characters of bear and the tree repeated multiple times, ended with characters for word science. So you can say like something like bear, tree, science, or like bear, tree, science. And the computer should respond to you with the Chinese characters means Siberia. So this is like with ideas like some reference to Novosibirsk, which was a traditional birthplace of computer science in Russia. So we can build this state machine diagram with arrows that shows the state S0, S1, S2, S3, and arrows. So if in our input we have either bear or tree, then we go to state S1. And if we, and instead S1, if you get more bears or trees, we stay in this state. Then if you have a character, characters for science, first character, we go into state S2. And then with another character, we go to state S3. And now in state S3, we can produce a word Siberia and then go back to state S0. So this is how a state machine works. And you may have state machine in your like other classes, classes on discrete analysis or mathematics. So essentially we can implement state machines in hardware by using D flip-flops and combination of clouds. And let's see how we can do this. So in the your lab exercise for sequential circuits, you need to learn the function of D flip-flop, which is the thing that stores registers. Then you can create a counter, which is a combination of a combination and a sequential circuit. Then you can connect together several D flip-flops to make shift register. You can create a finite state machine, and you can do application of state machine for interfacing sensors. So later on, you can also study the concept of pipelining. And once you study those concepts, you get pretty much everything you need to know to be a hardware engineer. So those are like basic tools of trade. And after this, it's just levels of complexity. So how to express D flip-flop in Verilog? So in order to express D flip-flop in Verilog, you write a special construct called always at post H clock Q is equal D. So practically this means that every time clock goes from low to high, the value of signal D in a D flip-flop, which is inferred by very is changes. So always block is similar to initial block, which we discussed on first lecture. However, with always block, this code is evaluated on each event described in described after it. So this assignment is called non-blocking. I will not talk about this much right now, but you can like study this later. Then we have another special signal called reset. So the signal guarantees the state of D flip-flop when we like turn on power or when we press a reset button. So if we don't have a reset, then flip-flop in our circuit may contain some garbage, and like our circuit will not function. So a group of D flip-flops is called a register, and this register has a state of our circuit, its current internal state. So we can create a group of register by using putting them in a array of registers, and in hardware they're going to be implemented as registers. Now let's see how register works in a waveform diagram. So you can see here this box is a register that consists of 8 D flip-flops, and when clock is coming, the input is copied into internal state, and the state is stored in our output. So you can see on timing diagram that on each positive edge of clock. So when clock goes from 0 to 1, then what we have in D is copied in the internals of D flip-flop and is stored here for a clock. So D flip-flop is essentially a one bit of memory stored for one clock cycle. Now, if we put two D flip-flops two registers back-to-back to each other, we can delay this signal for two clock cycles. So you can compare previous slide and this slide. So in previous slide, like every one which appear before this positive edge of clock was stored for this clock cycle. However, if you put back to back, this one first is stored in the first one, and then it will appear as output of the second one only after like after two clock cycles. So you can here compare. So when you have one D flip-flop, this two becomes here on positive edge, but when you have two D flip-flops, these two appear only here. This is how we can generate a simulated clock in a test bench. So we can create initial block in Verilog and run a forever loop with a delay of 10, saying that every 10 units clock becomes not clock. And if our unit is a nanosecond, this means that every 10 nanoseconds, so we can create a clock with a frequency of 100 megahertz. And then we can simulate reset signal by repeating waiting for positive edge of clock and asserting it first to 0 and then to 1. So reset is usually asserted low, which means that reset is active when it's 0. Now if we combine together adder and the counter, like adder and the register, we get a counter. And counter is a first useful circuit and first useful sequential circuit for you. So this is how counter works. Let me show you animation of counter, because it will be better. So this is counter animation. So you can see that when clock positive edge is coming, it records what we have on input and propagates to the output. So we start from state 0, and then this was propagated through adder was adding 1 to 0, and it became 1 was stored. And between clock positive edge is coming, we have here X, which means that garbage, which means some wrong information. So let's do this step by step. This is the most important concept in hardware design. And so please make sure that you understand this concept very well. So we start from state 0. This is two bits of our register. These two bits, two D flip-flops. We can store 00, 01, 10, 11. And now these two D flip-flops are connected to the output. And right now they're in state of 0. So we will observe 0 in output. And this 0 is propagated to the input of our adder. So it's propagated here. And while it's propagated in our adder, we have access, which means that we have sort of garbage information here and garbage information here. But because we don't have positive edge of clock, our D flip-flops ignore this X. So now we propagate 0 to here, and now 0 enters the adder, and adder's output is not stable yet. So then we added, so addition completed, but register still has 0. Then finally positive edge of the clock is coming, register is 0, and then positive edge came. This is called aperture time. This is just like when photo camera opens aperture, it's the moment when we see the outside world and can record image from outside to inside. So now this end will go to inside. So register recorded one, and it's about to be propagated outside. So now we propagate the state to outside, and now this signal goes back on its way to the adder. So the current state is one, it gets propagated to the adder. So one enters adder, and adder output is not stable. Now adder computed 1 + 1 = 2. The register still has 1, and then positive edge of clock is coming, and the register is still 1. So now it's aperture time again, and then we record 2 inside, and then this 2 goes outside. So this is how it works. And now this is animation, and you can clearly see like how it works. So once you understand this principle, you can visualize any processor or any graphical processor or any computing device as just very large number of such D flip-flops or register and a combinational circuit that computes new state using old state. Okay, so now before we go into next slide, which is a state machine, let's go back to manga and one second. So those are, can you share?
Yes, we can hear you, and also screen is visible.
Okay, so if you go back to, so can you see the screen?
No, your picture is.
Is it okay now?
No, we cannot see the shared screen, but your camera is on the screen.
Okay, let me see.
Maybe wait, share screen.
Can you see?
No, still we cannot see the shared screen.
Okay, just a second. Now I did stop sharing. Now I okay. So can you okay, share screen. Okay, can you see now?
Yes. Now we can
see. Good. Okay. So let's go to manga. So like again, so D flip-flop is a device that pays attention to its input only when clock changes from low to high, and when it happens, it copies D into Q, and for rest of the time it just ignores input. So now this manga shows how to build a sequential circuit which just switches what is the name of this thing? Okay, I forgot. So this is just switches state from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5 to 6, and when you press it stops. So this is a state diagram which shows 6 different states, and it stay in the same state when you press a button, which is button S. So then they build in this manga, so then they encode states in 3 bits, which are encoded using 3D flip-flops. And then they build a combinational circuit that converts old state into new state. So now let's go to example from a book, Digital Design and Computer Architecture. Oh, that's this one. Wait a second. Oh. Huh? Ah, okay. This is our... Okay, so can you see me? Can you see the screen?
We can see the slides.
Ah, okay, good. Okay, so now let me show some how a state machine can be used to create a decision maker in a similar fashion as a Chinese room thought experiment. So this is example where a circuit recognizes a sequence of digits of zeros and ones. So suppose you have a snail which crawls, you know, like in a paper tape with ones and zeros. And every time snail see 0, 1, it smiles. So, and you need to create a device that implements snails. So, and you can see that once we figure out principle how to do this device, we can create all kinds of all kinds of pattern recognition, including that pattern recognition with bears and trees and signs I showed you in one of previous pictures. So this FSM is a finite state machine, is a special case of a Huffman sequential circuit. There is a division between Mealy and Moore FSM. I will not talk about this right now, but you will see it in the course. So there are two variants of state machine. One is Moore and another is Mealy state machine. In real life, like in our office, we don't really distinguish them. Our state machine, which we use, for example, for cash lines or for transactions between processor and bus interface unit or for debug unit, they are kind of all mixed state machine. But early in 1940s, when all the theory was created, there were two classes of state machine and they have slightly different diagram. So in Moore state machine, you put your state is connected directly to the output, but in Mealy state machine, you can also use combinational paths between input and output. So, and this is state machine for this snail. So snail starts from state as zero. And when it goes through ones, and then goes through ones. So it skips all the ones because it's waiting for zero. Now when snail sees zero, it goes into state S1. And in state S1, it needs to stay all the time when it sees zero. And now when snail in this state see one, then it goes into state S2. And in this state S2, it means that it just saw zero and now see one and it can smile. So the snail produces one, which means it smiles. And then if snail see zero, it goes back to state S1 to maybe smile next cycle when it see one. And it's snail C1, it goes back to state zero. So in mealy FSM, it's more compact because here it can pay attention to also, so it propagate of computing from inputs. But this is something you can read later. So how to implement a state machine in Verilog? So first we need to create a state register, which is created using two D flip-flops, like state to store states from 0 to 2, so 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0. And it has to have variable for current state and next state. So we need to create state register. And this construct, so always when we see positive edge of clock or negative edge of reset, if we observe reset, we go into state S0. But if we have enable, this enable is just to make our state machine with like observable frequency, we copy our next state into state. Now, how we compute next state based on previous state? We are using so-called combinational always block. And this means that every time any input of this block changes, then do this action. So we are using case statement, which is simple, which is similar to switch statement in C. And when state is equal S0, which is simply zero. So we have here like parameter arguments. So S0 is zero, S1 is one, S2 is two. So when state is zero, we check our input. And if input A is one, then our next state is S0. Otherwise, next state is S1. So you can go back to the state diagram and see that this directly implements this transition. And if you go to state S1, if input is A, then next state will be S2, otherwise next state is S1. And same thing in S2. And then we put output based on our state. So if you are in state S2, then we smile. And if you are in state S0 or S1, we don't smile. So here, okay, now I want to show you how this finite state machine is translated into hardware. So I have another set of slides which I prepared for another course. So this is unit 3. Ah, no, this is the wrong one. Oh, here. This is good. Okay, so yeah, so this is our snail, and this is our state machine. So basically, if you go to waveform diagram, You can see that clock goes up and down, and then we have reset, which sets state into state as zero. And then we have inputs, which is 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1. And based on this input, our state goes from state 0 to S1, then from S1 to S2, and in this output, snail smiles. And the synthesis tool converts this Verilog into this schematics, where you have a register that consists of two D flip-flops. And you have schematics which implements a transition from old state to a new state. And then you also have clock which just goes up and down. Yeah, this already something else. So this is how snail state machine becomes a schematics. Yeah, so this is the most important concept in digital design, because like other concept is mostly how you organize those D flip-flops and state machines. Now, what you can do with a state machine in your lab, you can create interface to sensors, because sensors are using SPI protocol, like this, like ultrasonic distance sensor uses a simple protocol which can be implemented using state machine. And then this light sensor uses SPI protocol. So you create state machine and just follow those signals and the input data from sensors. So synthesis recognize state machine and optimizes it. And another concept you also need to figure out is the concept of pipelining, which is that if you have some computation which takes long time, you can split this into pieces and put registers between them, and then create a computation pipeline. But I think it's like, I don't want to put pipelining into this lecture, because this can sort of confuse you. So it's better to study pipelining once you get some basics using like state machines with flip-flops and sensors. But what I want to show to you is that a processor like CPU itself is actually a circuit itself, and this circuit has pieces of combinational logic and the registers where from memory and changes its state according to this instruction. And as a side effect, processor writes data into data memory. Yeah, so you can learn about a CPU using a simple processor called school MIPS. So this processor was created based on Harrison Harris' book by Stanislav Zhenyo. So he is an engineer working in Moscow. So he initially was working as a software engineer in Gazprom Media, but then he learned Verilog and FPGA and he became interested. So now he is working in a Russian company. What is its name? I forgot its name. It's like high-tech something. But this is a company which is making network devices using chips designed in Russia in a research institute called SRISA or NEC, which makes processors for for Russian like satellites and for space stations. And those processors also use MIPS architecture. Okay, so this is end of the slides, but let me also show you some pictures from another presentations I am preparing. Okay, so this is how FPGA works. Yeah, so you may wonder how those D flip flops and gates look like on a finer circuit, and if you go into like physical design, essentially they. Essentially, modern circuits, they are created using technology called standard cell. So standard cell is a library of cells. So this is example of standard cell, and each cell in this library implements like AND, OR some combination of like ANDs of AND, ORs. Or D flip flop, and they're called standard because they have standard height. And essentially, a modern chip has a large area with rows of such standard cells and the channels between them. So this is how a chip looks inside. Now you may be. Curious, you may be curious about pictures of those guys here. Those are a Russian couple, newlywed, which implemented FPGA projects and got second place in Intel Innovate FPGA in San Jose. So this is. They are on a picture in Santa Clara just like a few days ago. So they came here just 2 weeks ago, and this is newlywed couple. So they implemented their project on FPGA. And essentially after this class, if you go into this, you can also implement such projects and take part in this competition. And this competition for several years was only in Asia. And this year, Intel, which acquired Altera, an FPGA company, made this competition also in Europe and worldwide. And during the first year, gold medal was from this team from St. Petersburg, and silver was shared between another team from St. Petersburg and a team in Italy. And the third place in Europe was by bronze, by team from Ukraine, from Kyiv. And actually, person who won bronze, he won hackathon I was doing in Kyiv two years ago. And after this, this gold prize winner in Europe went here to California, and they just recently newly wed, and they went in Altera in San Jose, and now they went to Intel headquarters. This building is actually walking distance from our office in Santa Clara, so I frequently go to cafeteria near this building. So they are near Intel. And if you want to see more about Innovate FPGA, you just go to innovatefpga.com and you go to final. So this is so this is grand final in see a regional finalist. One second, how to do regional? Okay, let's go to grand final. This is a photo gallery. So you can see how this events work, and I hope some of you can create a project to compete first in Europe and then worldwide, so I may see some of you in Santa Clara and in San Jose. So this is what they did in Intel. And you can see description of their project on Hubber. So I put article here. And as I said, that their project was using two cameras to create a high definition image from two cameras. Yeah, and this is picture of a person who won first hackathon in Kyiv, Ukraine 2 years ago, and then he got bronze in European competition. So, and people who got bronze, they actually created a project to accelerate micropayment with cryptocurrency. And person who got silver from St. Petersburg, they created a project with text search using FPGA. So you can try to do various projects. So you can start from some simple projects. So you can start from some simple projects of interfacing with sensors, or you can do some computing blocks, or you can work with processors, with school MIPS, with MIPS FPGA. And once you get some simple exercise with arithmetic blocks, with pipelining, with sensors, you can look to those more complicated projects. So you can also get some ideas of projects from MIT Digital Design course. So here is MIT Digital Design Lab. You can just search MIT course called 6.111. And in this course, you can see different ideas for your projects. So let me make it just larger. Yeah, so this is called the MIT course, Massachusetts Institute of Technology course 6111. And they have a similar course with digital abstraction, logic synthesis. And they have a bunch of projects on their website. And you can find some interesting project for you. So they're studying similar thing. One of their projects, I don't remember where was the list of their projects. Oh, here, voice recorder, remote. Ah, no, this is their labs. They have complicated labs. One of their students, and I think that student was from Russia too, he created a 3D graphics using FPGA. Yeah, so you can get some ideas for the projects here. Okay. Okay, so I think that we are close to the end, so you can ask some questions.
Yes, we are really close to the end session, so do you have any question?
Yeah.
We can accommodate a couple of questions. Please. I remember one of the students mentioned something about, could you please?
Huh?
We have one question, so.
Where can we find the book that you shown?
Which book, about manga?
Manga.
Or like Harrison Harris book?
No, manga.
Manga you can get in that one, GK Press. It's this one. So it's actually okay. Let me see. Yeah. So I think that they already accept orders. So you just go to website called dmkpress.com. And you can pre-order. I think they are shipping it either now or will ship in a few days.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Any other question? Okay, so we have one more question, Yuri, here.
When we say that this hardware description language is event-driven. What do we mean by event-driven?
So event is essentially a change of signal. So when a signal changes from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0, it creates event. And when you have event-driven language, to have an interpreter of this language, you have create a data structure called event queue. So you can read about this using event simulation. And I don't know how much event simulation is studied right now, but you will definitely learn about event queue and the event simulation somewhere in your class. I learned it in my own school time when I was in ninth grade. There was a book called Pascal Programming Language by Gogonov. And this book had event simulation. And this is a general technique used to simulate things like movement of many of cars on a highway that create traffic jams. Or this is described in Donald Knuth's Art of Computer Programming. He is using elevator simulation in his volume 1. So let me find a good picture for this event simulation. So basically, this is actually a good picture. Yeah, so you essentially maintain list of event, and you go through this list and process event one by one, and each processing adds to queue other events. So this is how simulator of Verilog works when you simulate your, when you like interpret or simulate your Verilog code on computer. So when you synthesize it, it's another matter. So the simulation is just a convenient way to mimic behavior of on hardware on your computer. So when you go to hardware itself is a hardware. It doesn't simulate anything. It just works. But by event-driven simulation, it's a technique to mimic parallel hardware in the sequential computer. So your PC just a stream of instruction, and when you want to pretend that it works as many parallel, like many elements that work simultaneously. You use event just to process next event that happened with it. So in this way, you can like first process all events for like moment zero, which create events for like moment of like 10 nanosecond, 20 nanosecond, and 30 nanosecond. Then you go to time of 20 nanosecond and process everything that happened in 20 nanosecond and so on. So I would recommend reading some examples of event-driven simulation, because even if you don't work in hardware field, but work in software, this is one of things that software engineers should know. Like there are like several things which software engineers should know. One of those things are like sorting algorithm, like tree algorithm, like object-oriented programming, and event-driven simulation is one of those things. Yeah. So like I hope it answers the question. So one of events we were talking before, if you go to our always blocks, so let's get our always block. So every time clock changes, it creates an event. So where is that picture? Yeah, so you see, like with this verilog, this always add postage clock or neg H reset, what you have inside add is, so positive edge of clock is event. It's event when clock goes from 0 to 1. Negative edge of reset is also event. It's an event when reset goes from 1 to 0. And once you have event, you execute this piece of code. So if somebody of you do like Microsoft Windows programming, many things in GUI are also event driven. Like in Microsoft Windows, when you create a software code for like handling mouse movement in your window, you have event for mouse and event for like keystroke. And just here you also have events, but those are not like movement of mouse, but changing of a signal. Yeah. Okay.
Okay, thank you so much for your time and answer the questions. Okay, so guys, give a big hand to Yuri for his participation. Thank you so much, Yuri. So we are very thankful to you for this nice tutorial. And bye.
Okay, thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.